Trap is a pretty common gas chromatography application which looks for volatiles in water. As often happens in chemistry, the labels are determined by the situation. So what is a volatile? In the case of Purging Trap, a volatile is anything that will come out with bubbles. So if the sample will vaporize from the water into the bubbles, then it's considered a volatile. So what's a volatile? What does this encompass? Well, it encompasses anything that's related to gasoline, anything that's related to diesel fuel, kerosene, jet fuel, any kind of industrial solvent like methylene chloride, acetone, acetonitrile, tetrahydrofuran, hexane, cyclohexane, pentane, cyclopentane, any of the freons, benzene, toluene, carbon tetrachloride, a large range of bad guys are detected with Purging Trap. I think an intuitive, like if you tried to purge gasoline, when you were done, the gasoline would be gone because gasoline is all volatile. Purging Trap is used for detection limits down to parts per billion. It's calibrated from 5 to 200 parts per billion. So the sample is typically somewhere between kind of clean water to extremely clean water. So that we're pulling out really, really, really small amounts of these organic compounds. The heaviest one is, generally speaking, if a compound is a liquid at room temperature, it can be purged. The heaviest one that comes to my mind is naphthalene, which has a boiling point it's 150 or something like that. It's pretty high, but it will purge. So according to this definition, naphthalene is considered to be a volatile. So it's under the conditions of the test. If it'll purge, it's considered a volatile. Okay, there's three categories. The flow, which is related to the instrument, and then time and temperature. Gas chromatography is all about time and temperature, but let's start out by looking at the flow. The sample is put in a test tube, and the test tube is raised up under this thing and then locked into place with a nut and a ferrule. And then the gas goes in and is forced out into the appropriate fashion. Let's turn our attention to this thing. We have the helium comes in, bubbles, 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 bubbles. The air is forced through this apparatus. It's called a six-port valve, and I want to take a quick look at it. There's two configurations for the way the gases can flow. This way and this way. What you're looking at here, this is part of the machine. It has these tubes that go into this manifold. On top of the manifold is this little thing that turns. So this thing turns on top of it. It has an A-B position, the A position and the B position. So it doesn't turn, it just goes from A to B. So B, A. And if you look at the back of it, you can see it's got these little grooves that line up with the ports. And so it goes from configuration one to configuration two. So it doesn't turn. This is the only moving part. This little guy is the only moving part. The rest of it is just part of the machinery. I point this out because these valves are sort of common, especially in HPLC systems, the six-port valve. And also I point it out because I think they're cool. Okay, so back to what we were doing. The injection, the purge stage is, okay, so the helium bubbles, bubbles, bubbles. It goes through this six-port valve, through the trap, And then it goes through it again and then is vented. Okay, so it goes psh, through the valve, through the trap, through the valve, and then it's vented to waste. And in the meantime, carrier gas is going into the GC column. The gases are all helium at this point. The gases are all helium. These two streams are not really related in any way. They may come from the same tank, but they're not really related. So purge, 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 trap, 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 trap. Okay, now, after a period of time, it goes to an injection form. And the injection, the sparge is now out of the picture. The carrier gas, instead of going right into the GC column, now the carrier gas goes through this valve, through the trap, notice it's going backward compared to what it was doing before, goes through the valve again, and then goes into the GC column. And that's all there is to it. So that on the one stage, let's go through it real quickly one more time. Stage one, you've got the helium going, bubbling into the sample, goes through the valve, through the trap, through the valve to vent, and in the meantime, carrier gas goes into the column. Stage two, this is all out of the picture now. The carrier gas, which used to go straight into the column, it still goes into the column, but it goes through the trap first. That's it for the flow. Okay, and it uses this valve, and this valve has grooves cut in the top of it. And this valve is about, in the real world, is about maybe about the size of an old-fashioned 50-cent piece, not bigger than that. It's not very big. So let's talk about time for a minute. The sparge, the bubbling, is an ordinary extraction type physical science. Let's say in the first minute, half of the pollutants will be pulled out of it. In the second minute, half of the remaining pollutants will be pulled out of it. In the third minute, half of the still remaining pollutants will be pulled out of it. So it needs to go a certain length of time, and then there's a diminishing return as you go longer and longer. Typical sparge is like 5-6 minutes, something like that. And then the time for the desorption is, we'll talk about the temperatures in a minute, but the time for the desorption is typically a minute, something like that. And then, of course, the gas chromatography is a whole different, we're not talking about that at this point, but that's a whole different story. Okay, let's talk about the temperatures. The sparge is sometimes heated and often not heated. There would be advantages in heating it because compounds will go into vapor easier, but also then you have more problems with water. The lines are heated up. These lines go through a jacket, and they're kept at about like 120 degrees centigrade, something like that. And this whole thing is in an oven that's kept also at about 120 to 150 degrees centigrade. So it's all kept nice and warm and toasty so that the volatile liquids will remember that they're volatile and stay volatile and flow through the tubes properly as volatiles. During the absorption period, during the trap period, the trap is at ambient temperature. Ambient temperature being, I think, 30 degrees. So it's 30 degrees is like maybe 80 degrees Fahrenheit. So it's pretty cool. And then the trap is in its own little house. Let me describe the trap to you. It's about maybe a foot long. It's curled up into a U. It's got two nuts and ferrule, so you snug it down and you put it up, twist the bolts on and snug them down good. The trap includes a plug. You plug the trap in. The trap is its own little heating unit, so that when you want to heat the trap up, you don't heat up the oven. You zap 110 volts through the trap itself, and the trap is its own heating unit. The heating up of the trap is the injection. so that when the valve switches, goes clunk, the valve switches, the trap gets zapped up to about 185 degrees. So it's pretty much the hottest thing in there. And the injection all goes out as one plug. So it basically goes to 185. Everything on it is immediately desorbed, goes back through the two valves, and goes into the GC column as the injection. And then the GC column gets its start signal and starts doing its thing. Is that all there is to it? Let me think a minute. The trap, temperature. Okay, still looking at the temperature. All the lines have to be kept warm. Some of the lines are pretty long. They're it's probably like a 24-inch line between the trap and the GC. They come in specialized, insulated, and heated lines, complete with thermostats. And the temperatures are all controlled, of course, with the computer. Everything, of course, is controlled by the computer. The purging trap itself is about maybe 10 by 10 by 20, something like that. It's not very big. It has a typical computer-looking interface on the top of it. There's an auto sampler that goes with this, which has 16, typically, of these sparges, and it rotates through them automatically, so the instrument will do its work while the operator is home in bed. As a scientist, instrumentation is a little bit aggravating because it's completely arbitrary how it's designed. I've seen systems where the GC mass spec is completely independent. The GC mass spec does two things. It gets a start signal and it takes the signal from the quadrupole, and that's all it does. I think that if you went to a modern off-the-shelf purging trap GC, you'd find that it's all operated by the chem station, but it's a little bit arbitrary. It's not a big deal. If you understand how the system works, it's not hard to pick up a new system. A sales pitch on purging trap. Purging trap is like elegantly simple and totally cool. Purging trap produces no waste. There's no extraction. There's no, like acetonitrile, you've got to either dispose of. A typical extraction involves a blowdown technique, and the volatiles, which are greenhouse gases and toxic, are blown off into the air. There's none of that that goes on here. There's no sample prep. There's no waste produced. The only hazardous waste comes from the standards, but it's calibrated in parts per billion, so it's not really significant. There's no waste produced. The instrument is calibrated in parts per billion. Parts per billion. The calibration is 5 parts per billion to 200 parts per billion. The purging trap is an absolutely incredible concentration step. You're concentrating everything in 5 mils. You're not concentrating it down to a mil or down to a half a mil. You're essentially concentrating it down to a microliter. You're concentrating it down to one injection. And that's where the incredible detection limits come from, is that you've got this incredible concentration step. Another cool thing about purging trap is that the GC, gas chromatography, the operative word is gas. It likes gas. Well, you separate the analytes based upon their behavior as gases, and you never have anything going in the column that's not a gas. And the result of this is that you don't have problems with your GC. Your column doesn't degrade. It lasts a long time. There's no injection port that will cause you troubles. People that operate normal GCs with injections, you're constantly fighting with the instrument. You don't have those kind of problems with the purging trap. I think of this as related to mass spec. You've got small molecules with small ions. You're not injecting a bunch of junk into the vacuum space. You don't have problems with your source and your ion source, and the quadrupoles don't get messed up as bad. It's just a cool, totally cool and simple, elegantly simple technique. You go into a big environmental lab. So if you've got 10 GCs, 3 of them are going to be purging trap. This is not an obscure branch of chemistry. The recent mess down in the Caribbean with the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, the backbone, the laboratory backbone of all of that work is Purge and Trap.